Hello everyone, welcome to this video lecture of Engineering Hydrology. In this particular video, we are going to discuss about inconsistency of rainfall data. So what is inconsistency? When something is not staying same throughout, in that situation, we call them as inconsistent, right? Suppose you complete your dinner by 8 p.m. every day. So we can say that you are consistent with your dinner time, right? Now suppose someone else is having his or her dinner one day at 9 p.m., one day at 11 p.m., some another day at 7 p.m. So we cannot say that he or she is consistent with his or her dinner time, right? Now again, suppose some batsman is scoring at least 50 runs in every innings, okay? So we can say that he is a or she is a consistent batsman, right, or consistent run scorer. But some other batsman is scoring 200 run in an innings, but at the subsequent innings he is scoring or she is scoring 20 runs, 30 runs, 10 runs, okay? So we cannot say that he or she is a consistent batsman, right? In this way, when something is not same throughout, we can call them as inconsistent, okay? If you consider this particular clip art, you may observe that this person is bit surprised, because when he start climbing this particular staircase, he finds that initially the depth of the risers are small, okay? But suddenly he finds a particular riser, this riser is having a larger amount of depth. It means in this particular staircase, the depth of the risers are not consistent, okay? It means the inconsistency has been arised in terms of the depth of the riser in this particular staircase, okay? Now, again, if you consider this particular graph, you may observe that this curve is not consistent, because the rate of increase of the slope of this particular curve is not consistent. You can see here, from this point to this point, the rate of increase of the slope of this curve is consistent, okay? But suddenly after this particular point, this curve is breaking its consistency. So inconsistency has been arised for this particular curve also, okay? In this way, we will also discuss about the inconsistency of rainfall data. Okay, now, so what is this inconsistency of record of rainfall data? If a situation arises that the recording of a rain gauge station have undergone through a significant amount of change during the period of record, inconsistency would arise in the rainfall data of that particular rain gauge station. It means suppose we have a catchment area, okay? This is a catchment area, right? Now in this catchment area, there is a rain gauge station X, okay? This is a rain gauge station X, okay? Now from the year 1991 to maybe 1999, whenever we measure the rainfall from this particular rain gauge station X, we have get rainfall data which varies from maybe 195 to 245 mm, okay? Now suddenly in the year of 2000, when we go to the rain gauge station and measure the rainfall from that particular rain gauge station X, we get the rainfall of maybe 585 mm, okay? So you can see that suddenly the rainfall data has changed drastically, right? The change is very significant. So we can say that this rain gauge station X have undergone through a significant amount of change during this period 1991 to 2000. So we can say the inconsistency of record of rainfall has arisen in this particular rain gauge station X. Okay. Now what are the reasons for inconsistency of record in a particular rain gauge station? See, there may be various reasons, but some common reasons are like, you know, shifting of rain gauge station to a new location. If you shift the rain gauge station in a new location, the inconsistency of record of rainfall may arise in that particular rain gauge station. Okay. Now again, if the neighborhood of the station is undergoing through a marked change, then also inconsistency may arise in that particular rain gauge station. Now change in the ecosystem due to the calamities such as, you know, forest fire, landslide, or maybe flood. Okay, if this kind of calamities occurs, then the inconsistency of record in a particular rain gauge station may occur, because it is so obvious. Suppose if a catchment area is having calamities such as, you know, landslide, floods or forest fire, then we cannot, you know, collect the accurate rainfall data from the rain gauge station of that particular catchment area, right? Now last but not the least, that is the occurrence of observational error from a certain data. Suppose here is a rain gauge station X. Okay. Now when we measure the rainfall from this rain gauge station, we get a rainfall of maybe 240 mm. Okay. But by mistake, when we note it down in our copies, we write it as maybe 420 mm. Okay. So this is an observational error which caused the inconsistency of record in a particular rain gauge station. Okay. So these are some common reasons that why the inconsistency of record may arise in a rain gauge station of a particular catchment area. Okay. Now there may be a question arise in your mind, then how can we check the inconsistency of record, or you can say how can we, you know, correct this inconsistency of record if it arise in a particular rain gauge station? The answer is double mass curve technique. By using this double mass curve technique, we can check, or we can, you know, adjust the inconsistency record from a rain gauge station. Okay. So this is a double mass curve. Basically, a double mass curve is a plot of accumulated annual rainfall of the problematic station versus the annual rainfall of the nearby station of that particular rain gauge station. Okay. So how can we plot this double mass curve? Let's discuss. See, the first step to plot a double mass curve is a group of 5 to 10 rain gauge station near the problematic station is selected. Okay. We name the problematic station as X. Okay. Now suppose what this particular step is saying, suppose we have a catchment area. Okay. This is a catchment area. Now in this catchment area, we may have several numbers of rain gauge station. This is a 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 rain gauge station. These are various rain gauge stations. Okay. These are various rain gauge stations. Okay. And now we have a problematic station. Suppose this is a station where inconsistency has been arisen. Suppose this is our problematic station X. Okay, this is our extension. So the first step is saying we need to select a group of Rengger station, the number may be 5 to 10, okay, near the problematic station X. Okay, so this is our problematic station. So now first we need to select a number of Rengger station which is near to this problematic station. Now we can see here the near to this problematic station X, there are basically, you know, 1, 2, 3, 5 Rengger stations. See, this is Rengger station A maybe, this is B, this is C, this is D and this is E. Okay. So this 5 Rengger stations, this A, B, C, D and E are near to this problematic station X. So we have select this 5 Rengger station. Okay. Now using the rainfall data of this nearby stations of station X, we, you know, plot the mass curve. Let's see how. So the second step is saying the annual rainfall data of the station X, means the problematic station, and the average rainfall data of the selected nearby stations covering a long period is collected. It means, suppose we have the rainfall data of a long period, maybe for 10 years or 20 years. Suppose for we have a rainfall data of 10 years from maybe 1991 to 2000. Okay, so 1992, 1993, 1994, 1995, 1996, 1997, 1998, 1999 and 2000. Okay, so we have a period of 10 years. Okay, so this is a long 10 years period. Okay, now the step 2 is saying we need to also collect the rainfall data, or you can say the annual rainfall data of the problematic station X. Okay, so also we will collect the annual rainfall data of the problematic Rengger station X. So the annual rainfall data, annual rainfall data of station X. Okay, now suppose the annual rainfall data of the station X for the year of 1991, it was maybe P1, for 1992 it was maybe P2, for 1993 it was P3, for 1994 it was maybe P4, for 1995 it was P5, for 1996 it was P6, for 1997 it was P7. You know, in this way we need to write it first here, P10. Okay, now we collect the, you know, the annual rainfall data of the station X. Now we also need to collect the average rainfall data of the selected nearby stations. Okay, now see here we have select 5, you know, Rengger stations which are nearby to the problematic station X, which are A, B, C, D and E. Okay, so here we need to write the average rainfall data of the selected nearby stations. Okay, so average rainfall data of nearby selected stations. Okay, now suppose for the year of 1991 the rainfall data of, you know, station A was A1, the rainfall data in the year of 1991 for B station maybe it was B1, for C maybe it was C1, for D it was maybe D1, for E it was maybe E1. Okay, and then we need to divide it by 5 because we need the average data, the average rainfall data of this nearby selected rain gauge stations. Okay, so suppose this value is maybe P average 1. Okay, now again for the year of 1992, maybe the rainfall data in the station A was maybe A2, for B it was maybe B2, for C it was maybe C2, for D it was maybe D2, for E it was maybe E2 divided by 5. Okay, and maybe this value is P average 2. Now again for the year of 1993, it was maybe A3 plus B3, then C3 plus D3 plus E3 divided by 5, and maybe this value is P average 3. Okay, in this way we need to collect and average the rainfall data of the nearby stations. Okay, now the third step is the collected data arranged in the reverse chronological order. Okay, it means we need to arrange the collected rainfall data in the reverse chronological order. Okay, this reverse chronological order means, this means the latest record first and the oldest record last. Okay, so the latest record first and oldest record last. Okay, but why we are doing in this way? Why we want to keep the latest record first and the oldest record last? Because in this particular double Muschamp method, we are assuming that the latest record is more trustworthy. Okay, so we are assuming in this particular method that latest record is more trustworthy. Okay, so now we need to arrange the data in the reverse chronological order. Okay, so how can we arrange this collected data in the reverse chronological order? We need to write the latest record first. So we will write the latest year first, like 2000 first, then 1991, then this 1999, 1998, then 1997, then 1996, and this is away 1991 last. Okay, this is the period. Okay, now we also need to arrange the rainfall data that we have collected, okay, in the reverse chronological order. So see, here we have collected the rainfall data for the year 1991, it was P1, for 1992 it was P2, in this way up to P10. Okay, so let's write it now. Annual rainfall of station X. Okay, so for the year 2000 it was P10, then it was P9, P8, P7, P6, P5, in this way it will be P1. Okay, now again we need to arrange the average rainfall data of the nearby stations in the reverse chronological order. Okay, so average rainfall of selected nearby stations. Okay, the first will be P average 10, and second will be P average 9, then P average 8, in this way the last will be P average 1. So this is the whole process that is described in this step 3. Okay. Now the step 4 is saying plot the cumulative rainfall of the problematic station X in the vertical axis and the cumulative average rainfall on the horizontal axis. It means we need to calculate the cumulative rainfall of the station X, and we also need to calculate the average cumulative rainfall of the selected rain gauge station. So first we calculate the cumulative rainfall. So for the year 2000, the cumulative annual rainfall for the station X will be P10 only. This is cumulative, okay? This is cumulative. Okay. Now for the year of 1999, it will be P10 plus P9. For the year 1998, it will be P10 plus P9 plus P8. For the year 1997, it will be P10 plus P9 plus P8 plus P7. In this way, we need to calculate the cumulative annual rainfall for the station X for each year. Okay. Now again, we also need to calculate the cumulative rainfall or cumulative average rainfall of the selected nearby stations. Okay. So for the year of 2000, it will be P average 10 only. Now for the year of 1999, it will be P average 10 plus P average 9. Now again for the year of 1998, it will be P average 10 plus P average 9 plus P average 8. In this way, we need to, you know, calculate the cumulative average rainfall for the selected nearby rain gauge stations. Okay. Now, after calculating this cumulative rainfall, we need to plot it. Okay. So this is our vertical axis. Okay. And this is our horizontal axis. Okay. Now we need to plot the cumulative rainfall of station X in the vertical axis. Okay. So suppose the cumulative rainfall of the station X is maybe summation of P. Okay. This cumulative rainfall of station X is summation of P. Okay. And the cumulative average rainfall of the various selected station is maybe, you know, sigma of P average. Okay. So we need to plot this summation of P in the vertical axis and the summation of P average in the horizontal axis. Okay. So now suppose after plotting we have get this kind of curve. Okay. Maybe this is the curve. Now suppose this is the plot for year 2000. This is the plot for year 1999. This is the plot for year 1998. This is the plot for year 1997. This is the plot for year 1996. This is the plot for maybe 1995. Okay. Now this is the plot for 1994. This is the plot for maybe 1993. This is for 1992, and this is 1991. Okay. Now we have completed our step 4. Okay. Now the step 5 is saying a break in the slope is marked. Okay. So we need to mark a break in this particular, you know, curve. Now if you consider the particular curve, you may observe from the year of 2000 to the year of 1994, the rate of increase of the slope of this particular curve is constant. But suddenly, after the year of 1994, the curve is showing a different trend. Okay, it means from the year of 2000 to the year of 1994, the curve is consistent. It means from the year of 2000 to the year of 1994, the rainfall data is also consistent, but the rainfall data is inconsistent after the year of 1994, because after the year of 1994 means after this particular point, the curve is showing different trend. Hence, we can conclude a break in the slope is marked at the point of, or you can say the before the year of 1994. Okay, so as I discussed that all the rainfall data from the year 2000 to the year 1994 is correct, but we need to modify or we need to adjust the data that we collect from the year of 1993, 1992 and 1991. Okay, so how can we modify or how can we correct these values? Let's check. Now the rainfall data before the year of the break can be corrected by this relation. Okay, so by using this relation we can correct the rainfall data of the year of 1993, 1992 and 1991, because it has clearly written over here that the rainfall data before the year of the break can be corrected by this following relation. Okay, so you can see here the break has arisen in the year of 1994. So we need to correct the data of the year of 1993, 1992 and 1991. Okay, and we can use this particular relation. So the relation is that PCX is equals to PX into MC divided by MA. Okay, so this PCX is the corrected precipitation at any time t at the problematic station x. Okay, and PX is equals to original recorded precipitation at the time period t at station x, and MC is the corrected slope of the double mass curve and MA is the original slope of the double mass curve. Okay, so what are this MC, MA, PCX, PX? Let's check. So now we are going to plot the same curve that we have draw in the previous slide. Okay, so this is our vertical axis where we are going to plot this cumulative rainfall of the problematic station x. Okay, and in the horizontal axis we will plot the cumulative average rainfall of the selected nearby railway stations. Okay, now again we will draw the same curve. Okay, so this is the curve. This is the same curve as this curve. Okay, this curve and that curve is the same curve. Okay, now so this is the break year 1994. Okay, now inconsistency has arisen in that particular curve. Okay, so this is the original curve where inconsistency has arisen. This is the original curve where inconsistency has arisen. But if inconsistency was not arisen in this particular curve, then how could it went? See, if inconsistency was not there, then this curve would be like this. Okay, so this is our corrected curve. Okay, this is our corrected curve. Okay, now we need to calculate the slope of this original curve and slope of the corrected curve. The slope of the original curve is MA and the slope of the corrected curve is MC. Okay, so how can we calculate the MA and MC? See, if we take this is S as a baseline, then from that line we have the depth of original curve. This height is maybe A. Okay, and maybe this height is C. Okay, now the slope of the original curve may be, you know, theta 1. Okay, and if it is theta 1 and if this height is maybe suppose L, okay, then what will be the theta 1? What will be the value of theta 1? Then the value of theta 1 will be A divided by L, right? This is the, you know, slope of the original curve, and also the slope of the original curve is MA. So this is nothing but the value of MA. Okay, in the same way, if we consider the slope of the corrected curve is theta 2, then this theta 2 will be equal to C by L. So it will be C by L, and its theta 2 is nothing but the MC, right? This MC is theta 2. So this MC is theta 2. So this MA by MC, or better you write it MC by MA, because in the formula it is MC by MA, right? MC by MA is equals to C divided by L by A divided by L, which is equals to C by A. Okay, so this MC by MA can be calculated by C by A. Okay, so in this way we can calculate this MC by MA. Then once we know the value of MC and MC by MA, then we will easily calculate the corrected value of precipitation. Okay, so suppose if you want to correct the rainfall value of the year of 1993 and 1992 and 1991, then we need to just multiply with this P1 into C by A. So this is the corrected value for the year of 1991. For the year of 1992, it will be P2 into CA. Okay, so let's write it here. So the year original values . and the corrected values. Okay, so the year in 1991, 1992, and 1993. In 1991, the original value in the station, problematic station X, was P1. In the year of 1992, it was P2, and in the year of 1993, it was P3. So the corrected value are P1 into CYA. For the year of 1992, it was P2. So the corrected value is now P2 into CYA, and the year for 1993, the corrected value will be P3 into CA. In this way, we can draw a double mass curve. Okay. So this is a double mass curve. Okay. If you consider this particular mass curve, you may observe that this mass curve is for the year of 1954 to the year of 1970. Okay. So for this 16 years, this mass curve has made. Okay. And as we discussed, in the vertical axis, we have accumulated annual rainfall for the problematic station X. Okay. You can also call it as cumulative annual rainfall. Okay. The both are same for this particular case. Okay. And in the horizontal axis, we have accumulated average annual rainfall for the 10 station. Okay. Actually, in our example, we have taken 5 rain gauge station as nearby station of the problematic station. But in this case, they had taken 10 rain gauge station as nearby rain gauge station. Okay. And in this particular curve, the break is in the year of 1963. Okay. And the rest things are same. The same way that we have, you know, calculated this C, this A, and this MC by MA is equal to CA. The procedure is same that we have already discussed. Okay. So it is it for today. We will meet in the next class. Till then, stay safe and stay happy. Thank you.